Do you need to track some sort of certification? Maybe people in your industry have to get some verification for their employment, some certification that needs to be renewed on a consistent basis. Well, that, my friend, is exactly what we're going to be breaking down in this video. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I'm the owner at Gap Consulting, and it's our mission to help you get organized and automated with no-code tools. One of our favorite no-code tools is Airtable. It allows you to get very organized in a database, but it has the feel and look of a spreadsheet. So we're going to be using Airtable in our example here today to walk through how you can set up certification for any kind of business that has a certification that must be renewed on some sort of regular cadence. So let's go ahead and hop on into it. Now, before we actually start building, I first want to invite you to join me for my Airtable crash course. This crash course is going to teach you the key components of Airtable so that even if you're an advanced Airtable user, you can go and watch this and make sure that you know all of those building blocks and that you're getting the full potential out of Airtable. Grab that crash course at garethpronovost.com/airtable-crash-course. I will include links wherever you found this video. But without further ado, let's hop on into my screen and take a look at our new Airtable. As you can see, I'm working with a brand new database that I will be building from scratch during this video. Now, before we get into it, I first want to draw your attention to these colors. Can we just talk about the upgrade that Airtable has made in colors recently? I really like some of these different colors they've brought in. I feel like they're very modern and, I don't know, one of the best parts about Airtable is that it remains so cosmetically appealing. And I know that that's kind of superficial, but I'm grateful for it. I love working in it and it just feels good inside the tool. All right, I'm gonna pick this nice blue that I really enjoy. And let's go ahead and come up with a nice name here. This will be certification. And let's consider the different sets of data that we need when we will be tracking this. So obviously one component that we'll need is a staff table. Now sometimes we will not create a staff table per se, and instead we will use the assignee field. The assignee field has a user field type, and this would allow us to automatically link people here, assign the different things to people inside of our organization, and it would allow us in this case to essentially track. And this would be one viable option. However, I want to actually roll this data up and see it at the table level. As we connect, as we create and add new people inside of our database, I want to actually have a record of those people. And so I'm going to create a staff table here. I can still use the assignee field, so I'll keep this here, but I don't need notes. Let's get rid of that. I don't need status. I'm right-clicking and deleting the field here and removing it. Now, what I do need, of course, is the name of the person. So I'll go with first and last name. First name will be a single line text field, and I will have a last name, same idea. Last name is also a single line text field, and we will create those. So if I were in this database, I would be showing up like this. And the nice part is, as I mentioned earlier, we can keep that assignee field and just bring it in right here. And we can also bring in additional fields, all of them related to staff. So things like email and phone number and different key components that we would need in order to track that staff member. Now, I also want to make this leftmost field the full name. This is something that we do inside of Airtable specifically, and we want to make sure that it's as unique as possible, this leftmost field, but also that it identifies what exists in this record. So if we used an email address, for example, it wouldn't really tell us what exists in this record. I don't think about people and identify them by their email address. So using a full name in this example is great. We will use the formula field type. This way we are not redundantly adding data to our database. Instead, I will combine or concatenate the first name with the last name. Let's go ahead and add that in here. This is just a simple formula that is saying, take the first name, add a space, take the last name, we're done. And so as you see here, Gareth Pronovost, and then my full name is automatically computed. So this will again allow you to reduce redundant data inside of your database. We want to eliminate that wherever possible. And as I said earlier, we can add other things here like email and phone number and address and all that. Now we have to talk about another data set, which will be the certification itself. So let's go ahead and add a new blank table here, and I'll call this certification types. So maybe in our particular industry, we have two different certification types that we need to be considerate about for our particular industry. So we might have cert one and cert two. Now the reason that we want to create a table for this is so that we can assign additional properties to these certifications. For example, certification one, whatever that is, maybe it expires every year. So we can assign something like the expiration date or the horizon or however we define that. In our case, let's use a number field type and I will make it days. And I'll just go ahead and make that little refinement up there at the top and I'll make it an integer. I don't think about days in half days. So we'll go with this. So for example, if we knew that we needed to renew certification one every year, we could establish that it has an expiration of 365 days. For certification two, let's assume it's a 2-year profile. So we'll make that 730, as in 730 days, 2 years, and we will be good to go from there. Now we might have other information as well, like maybe the URL for where people need to go if it's an online certification, or we could include the address for the particular certification if it's an in-person certification. Whatever that is, we can go ahead and drop it in here like https://example.com, and there we are. Now, this is two of the three steps that we need for our particular database, but we are not completely done yet. We've established the core components though. We have staff, all of our staff members here, and we have certification types, all of the different things that we require people to be certified in. But now we need the key component, and if you are new to databases, this might get a little confusing. Now we're going to demonstrate a junction table. And really what this is, it's a third table inside of our database. We will create it from scratch. But the thing that's special and unique about a junction table is that it connects or links to two other tables that we also have in our database. So we will call this the certification schedule, let's say, and I'll save this up. I'm going to remove all the pre-existing fields here, get rid of notes, right click on assignee and delete that, as well as status. So now we can go ahead and build our linked relationships. First, we link up to staff. I'm going to choose a link to the staff table, and I only want to link to one staff record at a time. Let's go ahead and create that field. Now, similarly, I will create a link to our certification types. And here, I'll do the same thing, link to another record, just as we did before, and here I'm linking to the certification types table. Again, I toggle off multiple records, because in a junction table, what we're creating here, we have two links to two different tables, and each time that we link, we only link to one item. Now, I create this field. Here's an example of why a junction table is so powerful. Boom, I'll bring in a staff member. I have now access to all my different staff. I only have one currently filled out. And I can bring in my certification type, type one. Great, now again, Gareth also needs to get trained on certification two. So I have two unique records now. This first record is Gareth's current certification with certification one. The second record is Gareth's current certification with, well, supposed to be certification two, and I picked the wrong one. Let's do it better, there we go. So now we have two distinctly different things. We're tracking the same person against two different certifications. Similarly, we can track other people in our database. Let's add another staff member, John Doe. And we can track John and similarly connect him to different certifications. So here we go. We find John from the list. Here's cert one and cert two. Let's copy and paste and expand the table quickly. And I'll drag John down. So here we go, we see all the different combinations that are now possible. Now we can group this by staff if we want to take a look and see how staff is doing on their various certifications. We could similarly group it by certification, whatever we need to do. As a next step, now we need to bring in the date that the certification was acquired. So let's go ahead and have date earned, or however we want to refer to this, and we'll use a date field type here. And we can go ahead and put in any old date. Let's say Gareth received certification back in early 2021 for certification one. And then maybe back in 2022, we have this one. All right, so this is when I earned my most recent certifications on these two things. Well, are they expired or are they not? Since we have a link to the certification table, we can look up the amount or the duration that this certification is viable. So let's do that. Let's go and look up the expiration. And this will be a lookup field type because this data lives in my certification types table. So I'll look at that table. I'm looking at the linked relationship that we've established right here, but I want to bring back the expiration days, which I clearly spelled incorrectly back there. All right, let's go ahead and add that field here. And here it is. Certification one, if you recall, had a 365-day expiration, and the other one had 730-day. Well, we can now apply these days to our date earned. So we can decide or calculate when this will expire. So let's go expiration date. Wow, I've clearly misspelled expiration at every turn. Excuse me. Here we go though. Let's go with a formula. And we're going to take the date add formula. Date add down here allows us to manipulate a date and add or subtract some time to it. So I'll take the date earned, and with that, I will add a comma to the expiration misspelled field that we added right there. And I'll tell it that this is in days. If you recall, we're bringing back the number of days before that expires. Now, when we save up this formula, we see that it's actually not applying things as we would expect. And the reason for this is this number right here is not being treated as a number. Even though we're looking this up and we know it's a number, Airtable doesn't know that. So what we have to do first is convert it to a number. Now, this might seem counterintuitive, but sometimes what we want to do first before converting something to a number is talk about it or convert it to a string and then to a number. So here are the steps that we want to take. It's expiration that we want to manipulate here. And first we want to convert it to text, which we can do by wrapping a concatenate formula around it. Just this one little element right here, the expiration, because it's a lookup field. Sometimes Airtable doesn't treat lookup fields correctly. So we first convert it to text with a concatenate wrap. But then I want to convert my string to a number. And the value function allows me to convert any string to a number where possible. So what I've done here, this little chunk, is just saying, take that expiration output, first convert it to a string, then convert it to a number, and now Airtable is going to realize that I want to use that as a number. Seems kind of funky. You'd think it would happen intuitively, but these are kind of those nuanced things that happen as you explore Airtable more deeply. So let's go ahead and save it up. And now we see that we are getting the right dates here. The right dates are being calculated. If I have a date earned and an expiration, well then I'm calculating an expiration date. I can also come in, drill into my formatting, and I will get rid of my time zone because frankly, it doesn't matter for me. I just need to know the date that this thing will expire. Also note that this is going to expire one day early because of the fact that we have a leap year here. And so we would need to add 731 days instead of 730 due to that additional day for the leap year. But it's pretty darn close. So now what can we do? Well, we can say if today, the actual day of today, is before this date, then we're good. That means the certification is still valid. But if the opposite is true, if the actual day today is after the expiration date, then obviously this is expired. So let's create another field to determine the status of this. I will use a formula field here, and I will just write out logically in a formula what we just said in plain English. So I will say, if the date, the expiration date that we calculated here, if that date is greater than today, then that means that we are still in business, right? So if it's greater than today, then this is valid. Otherwise, it is expired. And we write that formula just like this. If the expiration date is greater than today, then this is valid. And this has to be inside of single or double quotes. Otherwise, expired. Let's go ahead and create the field. And here we see it. This one that expires in 2024, as of this recording, I'm in 2023. So this is valid. This is still active. My certification 2 is good to go. My certification 1 needs to be renewed. So how do we do this? Well, we can flag this in any number of ways. We can pull this data back to the staff and show that they in fact need to re-up their certification 1, but that certification 2 is just fine. So as some closing thoughts, let's go ahead and add those last steps here. First, I want to update this particular record name with a formula. Again, I'm going to use my concatenate strategy where I concatenate the two elements that I added here, the staff, and I will also bring in the certification types and close that off with a parenthesis and save it up. And here we go. This is now showing us this particular record is John Doe, certification one, John Doe, certification two, etc. We could also add the expiration here as well. Now I can go back and see if Gareth is compliant with cert one and cert two, and I can do that by bringing in on the staff table to see if I have expired or valid for my various certifications. So let's add something here. So I'll have cert one, and I will use a lookup field type, and I will bring in my lookup. I'm looking at my schedule that I've linked to, and I want to bring back the status that we calculated, but only in the condition where this field right here, the certification type, is only or is exactly cert one. Because remember, I'm creating this particular field and calling it cert one. So I only want to bring back the status of cert one, and I can create that field. So here we go. We know that Gareth is expired and John is also expired, but I can recreate this. And a quick way to copy a field is to hold down Alt and then left click and drag it out. And now I've just copied that field, but I will create certification two. And in this case, I will update this to look at cert two and save. And here we can see that Gareth has valid certification two and we're good to go. Of course, our choices here when we're adding and manipulating future data would be to remove his previous certification entirely and get rid of it, or we could add new certification ones and change our logic ever so slightly so that we're only bringing in the current or the most recent certification of each type. I hope that you got a ton of value from this, but do drop comments below if you have any questions, and of course, like and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. In the meantime, keep on building.